It's my great pleasure next to introduce Garn. One of the very nice things about being program chair of the FMA is to choose the keynote speaker. And for me, this was a very easy choice, and I was delighted when Garn accepted. It's very difficult to overemphasize the importance of Garn's work. If you think back, he really revived the whole field of banking. And if you think back to the 1983 JP paper with Bill Dittig on financial crisis and bank runs, I'm sure that it will become, over the next few years, the most quoted, most cited paper in economics, global tech, Jensen and Nankin things. But of course, that's just the start of so many important papers that Doug has written. His review of economic studies paper on who monitors the monitor, and the paper on reputation in debt markets, and I can go on and on. He has so many productive co-authorships, Rovarecchia, more recently Raghu Rajan, and all of these papers are just tremendous. And it's not just the work itself, but I think it's the enthusiasm and insights that he brought to the subject that excited so many of the rest of us to work on this topic. And I think that the financial crisis has just underlined how important this is. So macroeconomists and even financial economists had thought of banking as being something that wasn't particularly important. And of course, what we have found out is it is incredibly important. And I think that this is going to be a major field for many years to come, and Doug's work is going to play an important role in anchoring that field. A pleasure to turn it over to Doug.
Short-term debt becomes risky especially short-term debt, is very dangerous stuff. One, because of runs, and two, because of issues on short-term debt overhang, which are much bigger than long-term debt overhang. So short-term debt normally doesn't have overhang, but when it has overhang, it has a lot of it. And when you see that a short-term debt financed institution is getting into trouble, now's the time to get out, and you have runs, etc. And that sort of is the mechanism that turns sort of some losses into a crisis. So that's all pretty standard. So the thing I like to say, and I sort of every time I speak about anything vaguely related to economics, I say this thing: financial crises are everywhere and always due to the problems of short-term debt, or the payoff structure that is very much first come, first serve, like short-term debt. And it's also, the thing in red there, it's also related to the reasons why you need to use short-term debt in the first place. And I'll talk a little bit about those reasons, and there are a whole bunch of reasons. I don't have one view on why short-term debt is so popular. But it is very popular, it's used a lot, and when it's used to finance something that generates losses, that leads to a crisis. So you don't really need too much evidence for this, but one little thing that will lead into some theoretical stuff I'll talk about is just if you look at, this is just from the Federal Reserve flow of funds, this is the outstanding stock of commercial paper, and the gold line that goes way up and way down, that's asset-backed commercial paper, and you can sort of see that there's sort of a run or a trough or something on that commercial paper starting in early 07, and then it keeps going way down. So you can think of that as maybe a canary in the coal mine. There was sort of an elevated risk of a short-term debt financial crisis that was pretty, wasn't obvious, but it was pretty much showing itself by early 07. Second thing that's interesting on this picture is the red line, which is the stock of outstanding financial commercial paper. This is traditional unsecured commercial paper. And we see that sort of goes down right around, there's a big drop of it right around there, right around the Lehman event. And then it sort of comes back up and says, oh, the crisis is over. Well, no, the reason it came back up was the Federal Reserve's commercial paper purchase policy. And if they don't always release how much commercial paper they hold, but an interesting number is their 12/31/09 numbers.
That's how much they held, and that's how much financial commercial paper was outstanding.
So that's about 100%. So that clearly there was a liquidity injection into the commercial paper market through the Fed, and this is just one of the many things the Fed did to try to stop this crisis. So the other little interesting number, this is from Marcus Grunemeyer's paper, never actually ended up in his Journal of Economic Perspectives final version for some reason, but if you look at the fraction of broker-dealer finance that was financed by overnight repurchase agreements, which is another form of secured short-term debt, you see it sort of takes off from around 10 to 15% of their balance sheet up to 25% of their balance sheet between 2004 and 2007. So there was increased reliance in the pre-07 period on the short-term secured debt, asset-backed commercial paper being another form of secured short-term debt. And then eventually we don't see it here, we read about it in the newspapers, there was a runoff of the short-term debt on the investment banks. Okay, so obviously when you get a run on yourself, you have to start selling assets indiscriminately, or in a non-price elastic way. So when a lot of banks, financial institutions, hedge funds are dumping assets, particularly if they're sort of complicated to value assets, maybe they're not treasury bills, that's going to potentially depress the price. You know, if the asset is illiquid, sort of that's by definition an asset whose price is going to go down a lot in that case. And when you get into this sort of, you get into a general equilibrium where prices are falling because people are dumping and people are dumping because prices are falling, like in the 05 paper of mine and Raghu Rajan's, they have things happen. I'm going to talk about a simpler paper later in this talk, Fear of Fire Sales paper, which has some relationship to the Journal of Finance paper, but more specialized to the crisis. Okay. So a little bit of evidence, there's some better evidence that I don't have on this slide, I'll tell you about it in a second. A little bit of evidence for liquidity pricing, the fact that there was fire sale pricing during the crisis, is this blue line on here. This is the price of U.S. leverage loans, a secondary market price of syndicated loans to sort of high yield borrowers. And we see that it's sort of sitting there in, say, September of 08, somewhere around 90. Then it goes down by the Lehman period in the end of 08, down to around 65. And by March of 09, it's back up to 75. And then, you know, today it's back up into the 90s. I didn't update this to today. So you could say that, well, by March of 09, we figured out there wasn't going to be any kind of recession and things were just bouncing back. I don't think that's the case. I think a lot of this drop and this bounce back is very much liquidity pricing, a limited liquidity pricing, as Franklin calls cash in the market pricing, but you can think about it more generally than that. And as I said, there's a better picture I could put. There's a paper by John Campbell, Luis Vissera, and a third co-author, I can't remember, who has a very similar picture of this for Treasury inflation protected securities, TIPS, U.S. government bonds. So you could say some of this is about default risk, but I very much hope the change in the TIPS crisis during the crisis was not about default risk on the United States government. Probably was not. That very much was probably liquidity pricing, in part because a bunch of hedge funds, according to people at PIMCO, hedge funds had highly leveraged short-term debt repo finance positions in TIPS as a way of betting on high prices in the oil, the cheapest way to bet on high oil prices, which turned out to go down and lose money and be unwound. Okay. So that's just a couple of facts. So I'm going to say short-term debt is the reason. So why is there so much short-term debt? Like, why is short-term debt just so popular? And I mean, that's what I spent maybe most of the last 25 years thinking about that. And I don't have one good answer. All of these have something. It's sort of there's a demand for liquid safe claims when most assets are illiquid. So you don't want to trade the underlying assets too much. Either they're very illiquid or completely illiquid, as some people assume. So you sort of issue claims against them. That sort of creates more liquid safe claims. There's a demand for that. That's sort of Diamond, Dibbig, and Allen Gale. There's a demand for information insensitive claim. That's sort of Rob Townsend's costly state verification model. That's part of the story in my delegated monitoring paper, where the information it's insensitive to is information that only the bank monitors. And there's a recent paper of Bang, Gordon, and Holmstrom that extends Gordon and Panaki that sort of says, just in general, it's sort of nice to have an information insensitive claim. I might also mention Stu Meyer's stuff on information insensitive claims. Short-term debt also provides discipline due to the threat of a run. So this is like you give yourself the nuclear punishment if you're ever going to impose risk on people who lend money to you, and they run indiscriminately even if it hurts them, and that hurts you, of course. So short-term debt is a cheap way to borrow because it's a source of discipline for financial institutions in particular, and to some extent for firms, less so for firms. And there's also a good point made by Charlie Kettlemaris and Charlie Kahn, that short-term debt provides incentives for monitoring of a borrower and intervening to stop a borrower from doing bad things if they're about to risk shift or run off of the money is what they actually do. So all of these are reasons why short-term debt is sort of a cheap way to borrow. And some of them, the one with Rajan and the run aspect of the stuff of Diamond, Dibbig, and Allen Gale, those aspects have sort of a major downside to them, that it's cheap when it works and it's bad when it doesn't. So I think that's sort of the idea that I'm working with in the talk today. So short-term debt, why it's used, why it causes crises, and despite that, why people use it. So I think I meant the standard thing on runs is that if people run, if they don't run, if they're going to lose money tomorrow by staying in, they'll run today. So if people think people might run tomorrow purely because people think the day after that they might lose money, they'll run today. So you can get self-fulfilling runs, but anything that causes anticipated losses leads to runs. It's cheap, partly because of the ex-ante discipline aspects of this, partly because people like short-term safe assets. But I won't talk too much about this today, I'll talk about a little bit about this. Even though it's a good thing for the individual borrower, there's an externality. There's what's good for the individual isn't as good for society. So there's a too much short-term debt used in equilibrium. So in terms of the idea on punishments, so I'll just give a little intuition, this is all I'm going to say on it. So if I borrow short-term and if I do anything that will impose any losses on you, you run and you put me out of business to our mutual peril, bad for both of us. So I think about that peril to me when I internalize the amount of peril to me in choosing how much short-term debt. But if there's sort of a system-wide liquidity crisis and there's a short-term rollover crisis for everybody, it goes from an individual punishment to a group punishment, sort of like in the military where everybody in the platoon runs laps if one soldier's shoes are not sufficiently well shined. And maybe the soldiers use something called ex post settling up to internalize that one, but the ex post settling up to make to the one person who didn't shine his shoes well is too much short-term debt, just push the system over. We can't really punish those people, and that's sort of the reasons we end up with bailouts. So when there's a link between illiquidity and insolvency, things are bad. We hope that these things occur at different times. When they occur together, you get a downward spiral. So it's going to turn out, for debt overhang reason, that there are very poor incentives for financial institutions to behave well during periods where the risk of a financial crisis is elevated. So what I mean by elevated will be a parameter in the model I'll talk about. This is this period, like in early 2007, we see the short-term debt outstanding, asset-backed commercial paper outstanding, starting to go down. So we're going to say, maybe not a crisis today, but maybe it's a little less unlikely than it was yesterday. And once you get into this short-term debt overhang at an industry level, when the industry as a whole is under the financial sector, as a whole is undercapitalized, the incentives become very bad. So short-term debt is great ex-ante when it's safe. It's truly lousy ex-post when it's risky. It's even lousy ex-ante when it becomes risky ex-post. Okay, so that's a little description of what I'm going to say. I'm going to talk about a paper with Raghu Rajan, just the basic point from this paper as it relates to what I just said. There's the name of the paper. It's now forthcoming in the Quarterly Journal of Economics in 6 months or something like that. So this model sort of tries to address this point I just made, that in times when you have risky short-term debt and the financial sector as a whole is sort of undercapitalized, very, very bad things happen. Incentives of the banks to do the right thing are reversed, and banks start doing the wrong thing, making the crisis worse than it needs to be. And I believe that some of that was going on in 2007, early 2008. So a fact about the crisis was there was this sort of dry up of trade in the quote-unquote toxic assets or legacy assets, which basically meant mortgage-backed securities. At the same time, I'll show some evidence that you probably know about, that it became very difficult for firms to borrow from banks, not just small and medium businesses, even fairly large firms. And what's the link between these two, and how does this relate to this bad incentives from risky short-term debt that I talked about? So here's a paper from, here's a picture from a paper by Victoria Ivashina and David Sharfstein. I think it's either out or about to come out in the JFE, that looks at the newly originated loan originations, lines of credit, in 2007 through the end of 2008. So we sort of see both the investment grade and the non-investment grade sort of falling at the same rate and falling to pretty much zero by the end of 2008. They wrote this paper in response to some people at the Federal Reserve Bank of Minneapolis and also Northwestern, but mainly the Federal Reserve Bank of Minneapolis, who noted that lending was going through this huge boom in the fourth quarter of 8, and what is this thing about a financial crisis? So at most Federal Reserves, I've been careful with Minneapolis here, at most Federal Reserves, they know that most lending is under lines of credit. So the fact that total lending went up in the fourth quarter of 08 wasn't that there was this great supply of lending for new borrowers, but that a lot of borrowers themselves were concerned that their banks were about to go out of business, and they better get their lines of credit taken down the day before the bank failed, very much like a run on the commercial paper. So David and Victoria got this data on new issues of loans, and this, you can't get that out of the flow of funds, but you can get it off deal scan for syndicated loans, and you see that it goes down. So I'm going to argue this is about some kind of general liquidity shortage or abnormally high hurdle rate that the banks were putting onto loans, and I mean, it's not great because, I mean, this is the kind of kind of identification that would get somebody shot in a seminar, but I can say note that both the investment grade and non-investment grade are going down at the same rate. So you might say if it was just sort of macro fundamentals, it should affect the non-investment grade more than the investment grade. Well, I don't know if that's true or not, but it does look, the fact that they both sort of go pretty much to zero does look like it's not just all of a sudden there was a temporary blip down in loan demand. It looks like it was a shift in loan supply, the hurdle rate applied to loans. Okay, so that's a little evidence for this lending freeze, which will be part of what this model is about. So here's the model. Suppose there are a group of banks that hold some assets that are sort of hard to figure out what they're worth. These would be mortgage-backed securities, subprime mortgage-backed securities. And there's sort of a fixed supply of buyers in the short run. So what kind of expertise do you need to value risky mortgage-backed securities? You need one of these huge databases, zip code level things, to take house by house and figure out whether something is on this side of the golf course or that side of the golf course, or is it in the swamp. And there are about five such data sets in the world. I think now there are about seven, but there are about five during the crisis. It's sort of some of the big banks, Keynote, BlackRock. So the model I'm going to have isn't going to have asymmetric information among the people with those expert credentials, those databases, but those people are all going to sort of agree on what it's worth. And those of us on the outside are going to stay away because we're pretty convinced that these things might be maybe worthless. Because if these guys, these smart guys, wouldn't buy them, maybe we shouldn't either. But I'm basically assuming only this fixed set of smart guys can buy it. And the banks are going to face some probability of a liquidity shock, very much like the stuff in Allen & Gale. So this could be based on depositor or borrower liquidity needs. This could be the takedown of lines of credit. This could be a Lehman-like event and a panic. This could be just a fear of a run. Or it could be something a little outside, much like what happened in the month after Lehman went down. And Lehman didn't do the second half of repurchase agreements, so a bunch of convertible bonds and other collateral were sitting, being held by institutions who couldn't hold convertible bonds, not to mention the ones that were sitting in Lehman London. These are just the ones where the repurchase agreements were defaulted on, so the collateral changed, and then eventually those money market funds or wherever dumped these convertible bonds and put unusually high amounts of volume and unusually low prices into those markets. So the same thing in TIPS, so the same thing in leveraged loans. So illiquid assets will have to be sold at fire sale prices. And the intuition of the model, there are basically two scenarios to talk about in the model. Suppose that you get, so you're a bank, you're an investment bank, you're an institution that owns a bunch of these securities, you get a liquidity shock. Liquidity shock means you have to raise some money, so you have to sell some of your securities. So you have the size of the shock determines how many dollars you have to raise. Then the question is, what price do you sell securities at? The lower the price, the more of them you got to sell to raise a fixed number of dollars. And you can then say, okay, once I get that shock, if it occurs, and I have to sell at the price that will occur, will I be solvent after that shock, or I'll be insolvent? Those are the two cases. Well, suppose I'm solvent, conditional on the shock. I have to sell some assets. There's a fire sale. The price is a little lower than it was. I lose a little value, but I'm still solvent at that point. Okay? If I'm still solvent, two things will happen. One, everyone will see that if I and others have to sell this asset at a low price, it's going to be at a low price. Not just if the price has gone down, it's going to be low relative to fundamentals. So the expected return, the risk-adjusted expected return, or just in this model, there's no risk aversion, the expected return will be elevated. It'll be really high if this liquidity shock occurs. So there'll be some bargains around with some probability tomorrow. And anybody who has this specialized ability to buy these bargains tomorrow, they have one of these databases for mortgage-backed securities, they're going to say, I want to keep my powder dry. I'm going to require a very high hurdle rate, a very high rate of return on tying up my stuff in illiquid assets. So, because I want to make sure I can buy as much tomorrow if these things go on sale during the fire sale. So this discount rate, to the extent that the same set of experts, and it is a big overlap, the same set of experts value mortgage-backed securities and originate new syndicated term loans, you're going to say, gee, compared to yesterday when I had a lower rate, a discount rate applied to these, and this will work as a backwards suspended reduction in supply of lending to the extent that there's this common expertise. So that's all that will happen. The mortgage-backed securities will drop in price, anticipating that they might drop in price even more tomorrow, but the mortgage-backed securities market, if everybody stays solvent conditional on this stock, it won't freeze. But suppose the other case happens. If your institution gets a shock, it's a big enough shock and the price is so low that you have to sell at, that you become insolvent in that case, then the mortgage trade is going to freeze, because effectively we're going to get into the short-term debt overhang region. And by selling today, the bank is effectively going to bolster the value of their long-term bonds, bolster the value of their deposits, and to the extent they have any implicit deposit insurance, bolster the value of reduce the amount of losses that will occur if they ultimately get bailed out. So this standard debt overhang externality becomes supercharged when you're financed with lots and lots of short-term debt. And you, all of a sudden, if you have some chance of becoming insolvent tomorrow, your short-term debt is now risky, and risky short-term debt generates astronomically large overhang. So bank incentives will become totally perverse, and the banks won't want to clean their balance sheets by selling some stuff today at today's market price, basically somewhat low market price, but they'll hold on, and in fact they'll do worse. They might even want to double up on this bet. Okay, so there'll be a trading freeze, because implicit, one way to think about the thing on debt overhang is there's sort of a put that the seller gives up for free by selling the asset today and effectively buying insurance for the other holdings against the losses by selling today, and that lowers the amount that that raises the amount that they would require to take it off their books. It raises their asset price above the bid price that other buyers would pay. So ahead of this case, if we have conditional insolvency, there's some chance there's going to be a crisis. If the crisis is bad enough, it's going to bring some guys down. This is even absent problems at the moment. Bring some guys down. Those guys who might be brought down are going to take actions that are going to make the system worse if the shock actually occurs. So here's the model. 3 dates. Most dates I think I've ever used. 0, 1, and 2. Identical risk-neutral banks who own financial assets that are riskless and pay out Z for sure at day 2. The banks are financed with demand deposits that mature at day 1 with face value D. That D, some of those might go away. That's a liquidity shock at day 1 for liquidity reasons or whatever reasons I mentioned. And there's going to be overhang for one of the following reasons or all the following reasons. There's some implicit deposit insurance. There's some small chance or big chance of a bailout. There's some long-term debt on the books, or some explicit deposit insurance. Any or all of those things work to generate the short-term debt overhang. And just having it be short-term, but not maturing instantaneously between now and when the crisis actually occurs, that's actually good enough. You don't need any of these other things here. Just some maturing debt that hasn't matured this instant is really all you need. And here's the timing. At day 0, the bank has some illiquid assets, and they may be unwilling to take them, sell them, and trade them off their books. They actually might want to double up and buy more, it turns out. And then the probability Q, that thing in red, this fire sale will occur, this liquidity shock will occur. And with probability 1 minus Q, there won't be a liquidity shock. So then on day 2, the system is recovered, the assets will be worth Z for sure. But if liquidity shock occurs, because of this fire sale pricing, they'll be selling for less than Z. And if no liquidity shock occurs, they'll basically sell for Z. So we're not discounting anything here. And the way you want to think about the model is sometime in early 2007, this parameter Q went up. So there was the risk of a crisis was elevated. We went from the orange to the red or something in crisis risk. That's why it's red up there. And the banks had positions that looked perfectly fine for a low chance of a crisis. But now there isn't a crisis yet, but the chance is higher. And now they're going to be in the situation of this model. So will the trading freeze or not? So how much would a buyer, so you're one of these five expert buyers that can buy more. expected return as waiting, keeping your money in cash from today to tomorrow, and buying tomorrow either at the fire sale price, which occurs at probability Q, or not the fire sale price, which occurs at probability 1 minus Q. So if the fire sale price is P1 per dollar of face value, the rate of conditional rate of return you get if there's a fire sale, this bargain pricing tomorrow, is your rate of return is then a 1 over P1. So your excess return in the future is 1 over P1 with probability Q, and your excess minus 1, and your excess return with probability Q is 0. So you better get sort of the same expected return from buying today. So one way to think about that is the buyers are, in a sense, selling actuarially fair insurance to the party that's selling the asset to them. That's literally what the market price would be in a risk-neutral setup. You can adjust for risk, it doesn't change anything. So the price of selling the asset is the price of buying actuarially fair insurance against the fire sale pricing. Well, for sellers, for banks who might get this liquidity shock, and they themselves won't be insolvent, they're indifferent between buying actuarially fair insurance today, selling at today's price, P0, or rolling the dice, waiting until tomorrow, and selling at the fire sale price, P1 with probability Q, and the full price with probability 1 minus Q. So basically, the market, as long as nobody becomes insolvent and we don't get into debt overhang, the market won't freeze, the price will go down, the bid price and the ask price at date zero will both be below Z, because they're going to be way below Z with some chance tomorrow. There's going to be a super bargain tomorrow. But if some suits are going on sale tomorrow with probability a half, you're not going to buy one at full price today. You might buy one 25% off today, just to, you know, lock in the guarantee that you get some kind of a discount. But the fact that somebody has to sell in the future and it gets priced in today doesn't make that person unwilling to sell. It just sort of it's a question of whether they sell today at a moderately low price or tomorrow at either a high or low price. So from the buyer's point of view, this gives a high hurdle rate. So 1 over P naught, the date zero expected return they require to be willing to buy today before they know if there's going to be a fire sale, that's elevated. You say, there's going to be a pretty good deal tomorrow, so I require at least a moderately good today deal today on anything I buy that's illiquid. So that's sort of a contagion from one asset class to the other through this personalized discount rate. Yeah, this is just standard dynamic asset pricing. If this was everybody, everybody knew the expected return was going to go up tomorrow. It was like a discount rate shock or a technology shock in a Cox-Ingersoll-Ross model. Like, if everybody knows tomorrow the expected return is going to be higher than it is today, that will affect the required rate of return today. So it's like standard dynamic asset pricing, but here specialized to this set of experts who know how to have these computer data sets to value mortgage-backed securities. But as I said before, if the fire sale liquidity shock is so bad it brings some guys down, if there's conditional insolvency given this, then the bid price stays where it was, assuming the whole P1 future price given the fire sale constant, the amount that the buyers are willing to pay, that thing I called P0 before, that's now P0 bid. That's the reservation price of a buyer. It's the most the buyer would pay. The seller would be unwilling to sell for that price. They would require a higher ask price because of debt overhang. That's buying actuarially fair insurance. P0 ask would equal P0 bid. But the last thing they want to do is buy actuarially fair insurance to benefit somebody else who doesn't pay them for it. That's exactly what debt overhang is about. It helps the long-term debt holders. It helps the soon-to-mature short-term debt holders, and it might help the people who would otherwise bail out the banks. So this generates a huge bid-ask spread because the buyers don't have this put, but the sellers do, and the sellers want compensation for their put, their debt overhang put, and the market freezes. Okay. So this incentive here, caused by the distorted incentives caused by the truncation of cash flows due to debt overhang, the standard Stu Myers externality, but here in terms of short-term debt and not just long-term debt, doesn't just say they're unwilling to sell at this price P0 bid, and the ask they require is this higher thing called P0 ask. see, and we did see some of this during the crisis, the banks subject to a meltdown loading up on the illiquid fire sale prone assets, the mortgage-backed security assets. There's a paper of Marvin Christian Murthy and Jigwa Head that has to do some stuff backing things out that basically has some evidence that's consistent with during 2007 and early 2008, hedge funds got out of mortgage-backed securities and large commercial banks got bulked up on these securities. So that's exactly, if you think about the large commercial banks, they weren't right at the epicenter of the crisis like Bear and Lehman, but the large commercial banks clearly were a big piece of it. They were doubling up on these types of bets. Because remember, debt overhang or risk shifting isn't just say you want to get a risky asset. You want an asset with a right state contingency. You want an asset that's worth a lot when you're not broke, and who cares what it's worth when you're broke? Well, the nice thing about liquidity risk is the fact that you and everybody else are having to sell at fire sale prices is that's the state of nature that brings down the asset price by it. It's the selling that brings it down. So illiquidity risk naturally has the right kind of state contingency to have debt overhang be a problem. So you get, and the last thing, this is a large amount of chutzpah, during the PPIP, this is the thing where the Treasury came up with the idea to get the banks to be able to sell these assets if the banks had a put that was increasing their ask price. Well, why don't we give this put to the buyers so they can pay a higher price? So the PPIP, the Public and Private Investment Partnership, basically said if you were going to buy some of these mortgage-backed securities, you could get a no-recourse loan from the government at not a particularly high rate. So if this really blew up in your face, you could basically put them back to the government and default on the loan. So that was the PPIP. Well, the banks asked if they could, well, we'd like to buy some of these assets. In fact, I believe that the city asked if they could set up a new Chinese wall and bid on their own assets. So that may be a different story than my story. That may be just pure risk, but I have nothing to do with this model. But the fact that banks wanted to load up on this type of risk and not want to shed this type of risk gives you a hint that in periods where you see the risk of a crisis as being high, which I interpret as times when there's some chance of liquidity shocks and aggregate bank capital is sort of low, that's going to be a time when the financial sector as a whole is going to have poor incentives to behave well. And financial regulation needs to think about either controlling bank behavior during such periods or try to design capital standards and things like that to avoid periods like that. So low aggregate bank capital leads to these contagious and perverse incentives that gets us into the region of short-term debt overhang. And short-term debt overhang is a very bad thing. And this doesn't even require any bailouts at all. I mentioned there are a lot of other reasons. Just if you have some shortish-term debt which hasn't yet matured, that's enough to get all this going on, even with no government bailouts at all. So the fact that the banks are behaving poorly is in part because obviously they expected some kind of a government bailout or a government safety net. But even if the government could somehow tie its hands not to do that, these same perverse incentives, I think, would be there. The other thing you can see from this model is why the original Paulson idea to have the TARP, to have a reverse auction for to buy the toxic assets from the banks, why that was a bad idea. Because who would be the banks willing to sell at the lowest prices? Well, those are the banks who had no chance of becoming insolvent if there was a liquidity crisis. Because they don't, the value of this put, this debt overhang put, is zero for them. Who would be the banks with the highest reservation prices, the ones who wouldn't be selling in the auction? Those would be the banks most likely to bring the system down and have insolvency if a liquidity shock hit. So if you tried to have a reverse auction for less than 100% of these assets, you'd clean the balance sheets where they didn't need cleaning and leave them totally messed up where they should be cleaned. You'd have the banks about to go down still holding these assets, and the banks had no chance of going down selling them. So that is this debt overhang issue, short-term debt overhang, when the sector as a whole is undercapitalized, is bad stuff. So financial regulation basically has been looking, this is hardly the first 1,000 people to say this, has been looking too much at avoiding individual bank credit risk, individual bank failure risk, rather than thinking about the financial system. And from my point of view, which is a little narrow, it's not obviously the only story, but if you buy my story that financial crises basically don't another point of view, avoiding the excessive use of short-term debt. Short-term debt is good stuff used in moderation. It's good. You wouldn't want to disallow it, but the industry as a whole will try to use too much of it. So liquidity and capital requirements need better integration. And this doesn't require people say, well, how could any regulator or Federal Reserve Board member spot a bubble? I take that point. It might be very difficult to do that. This isn't about spotting bubbles, but about internalizing externalities and thinking about buffers against a particular set of circumstances. Circumstances where there's not currently a crisis, but the financial sector is operating at very, very low aggregate bank capital. So I'm not going to have time to talk about policy, but I don't get any royalty on this book, so I'll kind of tell you a backdoor way to find out what we say. This is a book that a bunch of us, put together by Ken French, have a bunch of policy proposals. Most of the policy proposals in that book are consistent with the framework I just put forth. Some of them are like totally orthogonal. So the relevant proposals that we have in the Squam Lake group are one, capital regulation linked to the debt maturity, the mismatch between liquidity and maturity of assets and liabilities, the size of a bank, big banks more likely to get bailed out, have higher capital requirements. There's a lot of lobbying against that one right now, obviously. The big banks are not in favor of that. And improved contractual failure resolution mechanisms with a type of reverse convertibles that are a little different than the ones proposed initially by Mark Flannery. Our twist is that in addition to having a trigger based on whether the individual bank is insolvent, it would be in an important way tied to aggregate bank capital. So in times when the aggregate, when the industry as a whole had low bank capital, say some blend of market and book, at that time it would be the standard for which this long-term debt would convert to equity would be lowered and more of this stuff would convert, effectively forcing the industry as a whole to recapitalize. Could happen just to raise equity at that point, but if you believe in liquidity pricing and there's like a liquidity shortage in certain times, like if you ask them to raise a lot of equity in the 2 weeks after Lehman, my guess is no bank could have done it. So this has an advantage of raising this stuff in advance. So www.squamlakegroup.org, you can have the first drafts of all our memos, which are not as well written, but they actually a little earthier, and we didn't require unanimous consent for things in those things as people who happen to read them when we voted on them. So you can see what we really think if you go to that site. And we're actually going to have we're still working. We used to be called the Squam Lake Working Group. We changed our name when we stopped working. We're back in business a little bit, so there'll be some more things up there within a month or so. So, in summary, the current crisis is like every crisis. There always, every crisis, I mean, even the 1987 stock market crash is due to the problems of short-term debt or the first-come, first-served payoff stuff that didn't have any short-term debt. It is like short-term debt. You want this an advantage to being the first one to get out. So regulations need to be set up to limit but not eliminate short-term debt. So that actually says financial regulation is not an easy task. You know, you don't say, oh, if you just outlaw short-term debt, that would be very easy law, right? But that's bad. And you can say, well, let's encourage short-term debt and let the market choose it. That's going to get you too much. So it's not too little, not too much, just right. So that actually is very hard to do without some kind of a quantitative model of how much is too much, what is systemic risk, and how do we measure it. So, you know, making this trade, this quantitative trade-off is a challenge for both theory and measurement, as well as for regulators. I was speaking to a bunch of PhD students who came by Chicago from different schools. We had a little grant to talk about financial regulation and risk management. And I passed this out and said, well, if you all could work on this, I think it would be great. I can tell you that the reason I'm telling you this for free is it's a close to intractable problem, and no one in my age group can solve it. So I'm really hoping you'll work on it. And if you think about it, I mean, we sort of, in other fields in economics, we have very, very good quantitative stuff. So like macro, everything is quantitative. Trouble is all their models are wrong. The difference is we have models that are right, but our stuff is largely qualitative. So we're both trying to come in from the different, they're trying to put a little bit of earth into their models, and we're trying to put a little bit of quantitative analysis into ours. But in be X percent here. This number should go up on Tuesdays and down on Thursdays. We have nothing like that, partly because we all realize we don't really know the answer to that question. So if we make some real progress over the next 20, 30 years in figuring out how to make some quantitative estimates of how these things work, it actually might be possible to have a fairly automatic set of financial regulations that didn't require super government officials who could spot the next crisis. So if you get it wrong, if you have too high or too simple a capital requirement, you produce too little short-term debt. And the last thing I'll say is what it really what you don't want to do is make sure that in every time, in every state of the nature and world, there's less short-term debt than there otherwise could be. You want to sort of miss a flight occasionally and go to the airport. Well, what you really like to do is never miss a flight. You don't want to go not to it, but you don't want to get there 6 hours before every flight. So too high a capital requirement could make short-term, the proper capital requirement possibly in many cases makes short-term debt without insurance always safe when there are no runs, but too high a capital requirement can go much farther than that. And trying to figure out quantitatively how to do this is a great challenge. And I hope some of you will be able to do that because I can't do that. Thank you very much.
Doug, will you take questions? Are there any questions for Doug?
So, one of the things, this is again touching on the quantitative aspects of regulation. So, the tax deductibility of debt in general and short-term debt, what do you think about it? I mean, sort of, for us, from a social planner's point of view, is that a good thing?
It seems like it's a bad thing, but I'm not one who thinks that's the reason, right? Because, for example, if you look at hedge funds that are set up as partnerships, they finance themselves largely with overnight repos. So it's not like the only reason that these institutions use so much debt and so much is the tax. And it's not, there's this huge literature for 50 years trying to find the tax effect in capital structure, and there's not a reliable estimate, really. It's clear that it has it's not negative. We don't switch to equity when you make the debt tax deductible. And so you can figure a little bit about the direction, but I think that's a place where there's been a lot of quantitative empirical work done that has not been very successful. So I'm not one of the things that you could solve the problem, say, by getting rid of the deduction. I mean, one very neutral thing, mutual funds, if they pay everything out, there's a pass-through to quasi-partnerships. I mean, some taxation like that for financial institutions might be a good idea. Would at the margin do something, but I don't think, and Hong Kong, the banks in Hong Kong, they don't have any corporate income tax. They're just as levered as anybody else, so I don't think there's any free,
That's not really the labor.
No, I don't think it would solve, it's certainly a good idea, but I don't think it would solve the problem.
Hi, really two related questions. Isn't a lot of your results a function of the fact that your experts are fixed in supply? And wouldn't the supply of quote-unquote experts be a function of the difference between the Z and that P1 price? And related to that, couldn't you get a crisis if there's a positive probability that Z would be zero, even without short-term debt?
Sure. There's two issues there. So the first one, could there be entry into this expert thing on a daily basis? So for the mortgage-backed securities, we know the answer to that is no. So, all kinds of hedge funds and all kinds of private equity guys got very interested in finding the tremendous bargains in these. But it was a matter of a year, essentially, to set up some of these databases. And it's very expensive. These are not the sort of getting the crisp tapes or something like that, which I recommend you all get. The people from crisp are here, not on the board. But this is sort of doing the daily tech. I mean, it's that kind of. So, and there's a fair amount of expertise involved. So I think for this particular type of asset, if there's a huge change in the excess some kind of ex-ante investment. You know, the price has to go down a lot. You know, the farther it goes down, the more rapidly people will start writing, you know, getting these databases. But it's not like it can prevent it from going down in the first place. And I can't remember the second half of the question.
The aspect that if Z could go
to Z. Oh, if Z could go to Z, so anything that causes losses causes runs. And runs make bad matters worse. That's true. So there's a whole section in the paper that talks about that. So one reason, potentially, that the U.S. Treasury was so focused on trying to get the market unfrozen was to say they could get some market prices in there to get some notion of Z. If the problem is Z is zero, then you really, it's a very different solution, right? The banks are just broke, shoot them or whatever, bail them out, whatever you prefer. On the other hand, if it's all from fire sale pricing, then you want to inject liquidity. Z is zero, you can inject all the liquidity in the world, but it'll have no effect. So getting the market going, either with something like the reverse auction, which is the wrong idea, or the PPIP, which is a little closer, is useful for that purpose.
I wonder if you've got a comment on the issue of the aggregate capital requirements. I know the policy elements of the are probably more adequately discussed in this in the book. But presumably in a globalized environment, you would want to take account of the aggregate capital system in its entirety, if that could even be captured. In other words, the global financial system, rather than simply an isolated case, even for a large country like the US. Because, of course, the short-term debt, particularly we saw in Europe, was very transnational. And therefore, looking at individual country financial systems probably is no longer adequate.
Yeah, no, I agree completely. I mean, one of the things that became even clearer in the system is that since we have all this very integrated world capital market, having individual country regulators looking, and it's even more important than in the capital regulation, just in terms of the way insolvency laws work, that, you know, you grab all the assets that happen to be in your country for the liability, for the different set of liabilities that your citizens happen to hold. That's a very bad system. So probably before I try to get, you know, we are supposed to have something, you know, Basel is all about sort of the globalization of what the capital standard is. But if we're going to write triggers, the triggers in for these regulatory hybrid securities, these fancy reverse convertibles, this is something that's written as sort of a term or covenant in the bonds. Or maybe it's something done by the regulators. So you could conceivably do something for the world, at least some easy to measure capital. It would have to be the fairly difficult. We're talking, you know, a couple of Asian countries and a few European countries that would, you know, be able to do that. I mean, that would be in principle a good idea. My guess is that you don't want the good to be the, you know, the great to be the enemy of the good. So my guess is that would be exceedingly difficult to do. So if at least the U.S. could do it, and, you know, say the U.K. and what is the European Union in general,